Hello, and thank you for joining us for a very special event as we continue our celebration of Black History Month. My name is Chantal Amiot, and I am Acting Director General and Vice President of the Canadian Museum of History. It is a great pleasure to welcome you to An Evening with Perdita Felicien, two-time Olympian, world champion hurdler, TV host, and best-selling author. Before we proceed, I would ask that we take a moment to acknowledge the land on which the museum is located, being the traditional unceded territory of the Algonquin Anishinaabe. It is vitally important to the museum that we recognize the traditional stewards of this land and that we continue to work closely with Indigenous communities and partners across Canada to share their stories in their voices and to move forward together in a spirit of collaboration and respect. This webcast is part of our ongoing series, An Evening With. Launched in 2019, the series has offered inspiring conversations and performances featuring some of Canada's most intriguing personalities, including Desmond Cole, the late Wanda Robson, and Jeremy Dutcher. This evening's guest will be very well known to most of you. Perdita Felicien is not only an Olympian and world champion hurdler, but a television host and speaker as well. More recently, she has also become a best-selling author of the memoir My Mother's Daughter, which explores her mother's struggle as a young immigrant woman and the enduring bond between mother and daughter. I would also like to welcome Toronto-based news anchor and host former elite volleyball player, Kayla-Marie Tracy. Kayla will moderate tonight's conversation about what it takes to become a world champion athlete, Perdita's post-competition life, her views on being a Black role model, and how her mother's struggle and triumphs have helped shape the woman she has become. The evening concludes with what is sure to be an engaging question and answer session. I'm thrilled to announce that we have received an important donation from Perdita to our national collection, consisting of 9 artifacts and 26 archival items documenting her life and career. The donation includes her uniform from the 2003 World Championship, where she not only took gold, but also became the first and still today the only Canadian woman to win a gold medal at an IAAF World Championship event, as well as the youngest person to ever win the 100-meter hurdles. How exciting. The Perdita Felicien collection documents the highs and lows of life as an elite athlete and Felicien's fascinating journey to the podium and beyond. This acquisition is part of a larger initiative the museum is undertaking to build its sport collection and bring you closer to some of Canada's most dynamic and memorable personalities. This series would not be possible without its sponsor, TD Bank Group. Before handing things over to our moderator, Kayla, the TD Bank Group has this message.
Black History Month, a time to remember, recognize, and reflect. While we'll celebrate, we also heard the call from communities and within to do more. More than just talk about inequity and injustice, but to add our efforts to the Black excellence all around us. At TD, we support people and opportunities that help inspire, amplify, and elevate Black communities. We are committed to do more than talk the talk.
Chantal, thank you so much for that introduction. And ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Welcome to An Evening with Perdita Felicien. My name is Kayla-Marie Tracy. As she mentioned, I'm a Toronto-based news anchor and reporter, and it is my pleasure to have a sit-down, comfortable conversation with an amazing Canadian who you are going to be able to learn a little bit more than just her accolades on the track and field, as well as you may have seen her on your TV screens, giving you the very latest for the Beijing Olympics. We're going to get into that in just a moment, but right now we're going to play a video that gives you a little bit more insight into who Perdita Felicien is.
Perdita Felicien is a two-time world champion, a two-time Olympian, and a 10-time Canadian national champion. She's the only woman in Canadian history to ever win a gold medal at the World Track and Field Championships. During her career as a 100-meter hurdler, she earned numerous honors, including Canada's Female Athlete of the Year, Keys to the City of Pickering, and the Queen Elizabeth Diamond Jubilee Medal. Perdita retired from professional sport in 2013 and is now a best-selling author.
80,000 people know my name.
Sports broadcast.
They were like, who is this guy? Like, who's this man? Yeah, he's from the sixth.
As well as the host of the television show All Round Champion.
Welcome back, athletes. It's time to raise the bar.
She's covered multiple international sporting events, from the 2018 Olympic Winter Games to the 2016 and 2020 Summer Olympics for CBC.
That's your rowing technique?
Please, no.
Perdita has recently written her first book. My Mother's Daughter was released in spring 2021 and is now available wherever books are sold. An instant national bestseller, Perdita's memoir chronicles the highs and lows of her illustrious racing career, along with her experience with homelessness and being a child witness to domestic abuse. Perdita is an advocate for multiple humanitarian organizations, including the Denise House, the women's emergency shelter in Oshawa, Ontario, that she credits with helping her family get on their feet in the late 1980s. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Perdita Felicien.
And without further ado, I want to bring in someone who I am very honored to call a dear friend as well. Perdita, good evening to you.
Hello.
And it's so great to see you.
So good.
How are you?
I am so good. And how are you, Miss Mama? I should call you that. New mom. Kayla's had a new baby, you guys. Her name's Kennedy. She's 3 weeks old. And we just saw her offline earlier. So cute.
We are definitely going to jump into motherhood at some point in this conversation. There's no doubt about it. But one thing that I loved about that video that we just watched is the fact that when you say, you know, who is Perdita? My goodness, like, name it off. Name all of the things, right? Olympian, world record holder, world record breaker, author, wife, mother, friend, sister, you have all of these roles. And so tonight I want to begin with one probably that majority of the people know you for, and that's as an athlete, you know, as a world-class hurdler, and where it all began for Perdita, because I know that a lot of people may see the accolades and that you've had the highest of highs, but you've also had the lowest of lows as well. So let's start this evening off with, where did it all begin for you?
Yeah. So, I feel like I'm coming full circle, right? Like, cause I'm here covering like the Winter Olympics, talking about that. And honestly, sometimes I'm humbled because I understand the journey and the walk that all these athletes have to go through. And when you see someone come to like that level of sport, we don't have the privilege of seeing like what that journey has been like usually. So for me, it was, I'm at Glen Grove Public School in Pickering, okay? It's like 1987, okay? And I was doing a course like called Canada Fitness. So the whole like country did it. It was like a standardized test. And I was like in grade three. And Mrs. Arthur's was my gym teacher, but she was also my homeroom teacher. And so we did all the tests. Like, I don't remember, they were like the 100, the long jump, like the push-ups, like just a whole bunch of stuff. But then they score you and then they take all these results and they get there's some formula and they send them out to whatever. And then they like compare that to like the whole country based on your age and whatever your results were. And they send everything back. And there's like all these badges and all these awards. So the day that Mrs. Arthur's in grade three, at Glen Grove Public School in Pickering, is giving out all these awards, she gives out all of them. Now, this is the thing about Canada Fitness, okay? There's levels to this, levels. So there's like, if you didn't do so hot, but you were keen, you got like a little participation pin, okay? So that's like the lowest. No shade there if you got that. And then there's like bronze and then there's silver and gold, but then there's something beyond gold, okay? Not something even the Olympics have gold. Beyond gold. Could you imagine?
And in elementary school at that, like, come on.
So you're living lavish, okay, if you get this level, but no one gets this level. So excellence. And so she gives out all the awards and then Mrs. Arthur's, and you, I don't know if you remember grade three, right? Or like elementary school, like you sit in these little shuttles in gym class, right? Yep. So we're all sitting and then she's like, okay, boys and girls, everyone get back down. Everything's good. And I want to, and then, so she makes a separate moment. There's one person in our entire class, boys and girls, is the only person in an entire class to get the highest level excellence. I don't even realize what's happening. I'm just like, oh, this is a juicy tale. Like, keep talking, Miss Arthur. Who's this? And then she calls my name. I didn't even realize, Kayla, that it was me. And she, that moment was for me so like, I was recognized. And, you know, I remember walking up and feeling like I would burst into confetti. And the next year, when I was old enough, at 9 years old, to try it for track and field, Mrs. Arthur has made sure she came and got me and signed me up. And the reason track was so easy for me to get to is there weren't like all this fancy equipment and all these dues and all this. Like, you literally needed your body and you needed a pair of shoes, which was what we could afford and what I had at the time. So it was like the perfect mix for me.
You know, and we're going to get into more of your journey and, you know, how it correlates, especially with the relationship with your mother, in a bit. But before we even dive into the next question, I actually want to give a shout out to the Ottawa-Carleton District School Board, Black Youth Forum course students, as well as Adrienne Caudette, who is their teacher, because all of them have read your book and they've also provided some amazing questions about a variety of things. And so that actually leads me into the first question, because I want to incorporate some of mine, but as well as some of theirs, because they are on right now and they are listening. And so thank you all for being here this evening. And I'm going to start with Ori's question. And it says, how does it feel to be an inspiration to the younger generation, to your own children, and to anyone who is facing troubles that you did as a kid when you didn't have many role models in your childhood? And I bring that up because you were just talking about the fact that your journey got started at such a young age, and almost, you would say, by a string of luck. Like, it was just this, you happened to have this test, and then you recognized that you had this gift, this God-given gift and talent.
For sure. And, you know, when you first, and I'm going to slow down because I know we have people interpreting and I talk fast and I get excited. So I'm going to try and definitely like pace myself. Okay. They tell me that all the time on TV. You talk so fast. Okay. I'm going to slow down. I'm a sprinter though, but I'm going to slow down.
You and me both.
Yeah. But, and then we get together. So we're going to pace. Okay. Here we go now. Here I go. So yeah, being a role model, here's the thing about being a role model as an elite athlete and anyone who has any kind of platform or stage. When you first start, at least me, like when I was on the world stage or just national, being nationally recognized back in the early 2000s, mm-hmm. I didn't sign up for that. Me being an example to your children, where, how? That was not something I signed up for. I was doing a sport I loved and I enjoyed. And I remember the first time I read an article saying Perdita Felicien is a role model. And I was kind of like, whoa, because there's a weight and a responsibility to that. What you say, where you go, how you say it, you know what I mean? Who you lend your likeness and your name to. And it was a weight that I was like, oh, what if I mess up? This is intense. And I didn't accept it at first. This is just being really authentic. I didn't accept it at first because it felt too awesome of a responsibility. But then what happened? No one stopped calling me a role model. Like, just, I said I'm not, but people kept putting that on me and calling me. And one day I decided, it was after I won the world championships in 2003. I was like, oh no, this is, you have a platform, girl, and you should use it. And that's when I truly accepted and adopted the role. So the answer is this. When I first was doing it, I enjoyed it and I still enjoy it to this day, but it was more like, I was very conscious about, okay, this. Now, as a 40 something year old woman, I'm like, oh, there's privilege here. There's weight and there is opportunity here to truly make sure that any door I walk through, others can walk through it. How I show up, what I say, how I look. By virtue of me even being a Black woman, a Black Canadian athlete hosting a Winter Olympics, I haven't checked the record books, but I'm pretty confident that's the first in this nation. And I'm very conscious about what I represent, right? And Kayla, seeing you on TV, carrying the news, we represent something to our communities. We represent something. And I don't know if you feel that same kind of responsibility, but I wear it and I carry it and I own it. Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a heavy weight, like you said, and it can be nerve-wracking, but it's so important. And I love the fact that you brought up the fact that, yes, especially you mentioned as not only as a woman, but as a Black Canadian woman, when, you know, representation is so important, because you're talking about young women, young girls, young boys, regardless, who are watching at such a young age. And sometimes they have been told, whether it's not directly, but indirectly, that sometimes they don't see a reflection of themselves. And so when it comes to that reflection, and you look back on your upbringing, and you know, whether it was in the classroom, as well as on the track, did you have that representation? Did you see yourself? Or did you sort of, because you are a trailblazer at this point, was there anyone that that blazed the trail for you that you looked at to? Or did you, was it a bit lonely kind of having to navigate on your own?
Yeah, so thank God, I know we'll talk about this, but I had my mother who was always my beacon and my North Star. So I always had her, and she's a strong character. If you've read my book, everyone, she's a strong character. But mother aside, when it comes to like what I wanted to do career-wise or who I wanted to be, there was Oprah Winfrey. I mean, that's the only role model anyone ever needs in life. So I had Oprah Winfrey. Mm-hmm. The Young and the Restless, my mom loves soap operas. So I think it was Tanya Lee Williams was a character on Young and the Restless. She's Canadian, yes, by the way.
She is Canadian. Yep, she is.
She's Canadian. And so I would see her on the TV, but by then I didn't have any ambitions of being on televisions. And there's a subconscious thing, I'll be honest, about not necessarily seeing yourself in those realms, right? On magazine covers or as a standard of beauty or, you know, everywhere on television. So very subconsciously, you don't even think that that's something you could do. But sport and athletics, well, there's a lot of Black role models and Black, you know, people in there. So that's what you tend to gravitate. And what I truly love about this generation and the last 2 years of really a racial uprising is now people of color and white people, yes, are now opening up to the realization that, oh, I didn't build the system. No one is blaming me for the system, but I do have some influence and some power here. So let me change what I can. And so it's almost like now we're taking up spaces and we're at these tables where you generally wouldn't always see us. And then what does that signal to, you know, a brown girl or a brown boy or a Black girl or Black boy when they see you, you know, in all these different spaces? Consciously, you're like, oh, Perdita Felicien's calling the Winter Olympics and she's a summer athlete and I could do that. I could do that or any industry. And that's why we keep talking about representation. And I pray and I hope nobody is tired about having the conversation. Even though it's difficult, Kayla, to have the conversation, we need to, because you have a three-week-old, right? You have a three-week-old daughter. I have a daughter who's about to be 3 years old. If we are truly going to make change that ripples out for generations, the conversation can't last for 1 year, 2 years. It has to actually last our lifetime. Is the conversation uncomfortable on both ends? Absolutely. Is it exhausting at times? Absolutely. But we have to do the work if we are going to change things. And so for me, I want to be that role model now, not just in sports, because Black people can do more than just sports, right? We write best-selling books, right? Yes, we're on TV being anchors and mothers and wives and in science and in music. We're in all these realms. We just need to be seeing that more and celebrating that more.
So well said. I want to jump back into when it comes to your athletic accolades, right? Because when we're talking accolades, my girl has them, okay? And quite a bit. Yes, you should dust off your shoulders for that. When it comes to those achievements and you look back when you were, your story is very unique in the sense that you are 41 years young at the moment, and yet, but which with so much still ahead of you, but yet you've had so much success at such a young age. Yeah. How was that? How was it carrying notoriety, success? Yeah. Yeah. The weight of a country on your shoulders as an athlete at such a young age?
Yeah, that's no one's ever asked me that question ever. I'll be honest with you. I think they see the sum of it and it looks nice on paper and it sounds good to say, but they don't ask you what it cost you. Mm-hmm. And like you just alluded to, you pay something for that, right? There's a price that I've paid for that. And I will say this, I've been retired now almost 10 years. Almost 10 years, but I've been retired for 10 years. Look at, that's my wall in high school, by the way. That's my wall in high school. Cool, right? Listen, cool.
That's beyond cool.
So
that's
neat.
Nova's inspiration right there.
There you go. Don't zoom in though. There's some other stuff on there. I don't even know what the heck I was into in 1997, but there we go. So yeah, there's a weight to it and a cost to it. I will say this quickly though. I'm an Olympian and we're following the Olympics right now. And I don't know if anyone realizes this, we probably do, but really Olympians are judged by whether you've won a medal, and especially by you winning a gold medal. And as much as I was the top hurdler in the world, not just Canada, but in the world for nearly like a decade, I've won world titles, I've smashed records, you know, I've done all these things. I've had, you know, sponsorships and brands. I've been on billboards, I've been on subways, like all of that is nice. But Kayla, out of all of that, I do not have an Olympic medal. I don't even have, I don't even have an Olympic final finish, considering what happened in 04. So when you ask me that, for a long time, I knew I did all that stuff and it's good and it's cool. And I recognize that it's very substantial. Like even a fraction of that is very substantial. But because I never had that Olympic title, and everyone, even till this day, and I accept it is what it is, frames me through, you know, falling in 04 at the Olympics. In a way, it kind of cancels out all the other awesome stuff that I've done, because I'm the girl who fell at the Olympics and I'm a world champion, right? And there's very little room for all the other stuff that you described, right? And because you are a retired elite athlete, you understand winning a conference title, breaking a record, like you understand what those things in between, in that in-between time of the Olympics is huge, right? But people don't, they don't rate that. They don't see that. And so for a long time in my own heart and mind, and to other people, I was always the girl who fell. And so it was hard to ever pay attention to any of that stuff because, well, I never won the Olympics, or I'm always the girl that fell at the Olympics and no one ever sees that other stuff because Athens has so much overshadowed, at least to the general public, has overshadowed that. Now, as someone who's 41, I will say this about where I am in my journey and in my life. I am fiercely proud of everything that I've done and accomplished on the track. And not having that Olympic title, not having that Olympic finish or that Olympic medal in my mind and my heart no longer overshadows or kind of cancels out the, you know, how grand and how wonderful those things I did are, if that makes sense. Like, no, I did that. I don't have an Olympic medal. I would have loved to have one, but girl, you were still the ish. Do you know what I mean?
Absolutely. And I think that it's very easy for people, for fans, for, you know, just for anyone who can view the situation from an outside lens and just peg that one moment in 04, when truth be told, it's like, you have no idea what it cost me to get to that moment, the thousands and thousands of hours of hard work and determination and all of the other accolades that you achieved leading up to that. And you talk and you go into in depth into how you felt and all of the hard work that you dedicated leading up to your Olympics and a number of different competitions in your memoir, In My Mother's Daughter. And this book is absolutely incredible for so many reasons, but I really want to, you know, talk about the relationship that you have with your amazing and strong mother, Catherine, because if for those who may not have read the book yet, you really don't hold back when it comes to describing the hardships that she truly had to go through from starting her life off in St. Lucia and the sacrifices that she made in order to come to Canada and start a new life. And you being a product, a byproduct of her sacrifice. How is your relationship now with your mother as you are a mother yourself now, and you can now reflect as an adult, looking back and reflecting on the sacrifices that you didn't understand that were going on behind the scenes when you were a little girl?
Yes. And I know you're only 3 weeks into your mother journey. And you and I have talked a lot about your journey, and I feel like, and I'm sure you feel this way, there's a new lens that you have now, right? Being a mama bear, like it's different. Like the perspective that you have as a woman and as a mother changes. And there's an appreciation I have for my mother's journey and her struggle, right? And, you know, my relationship with my mother is the best it's ever been. I've been away from my mother and my daughter and my husband for about 2.5 weeks now because of the Olympics. And my mother is taking care of Nova. And my mother, for those of you who read my mother's daughter, my mother immigrated to Canada as a teen mother, and she left her two young children. I wasn't there. They were 1 and 2 at the time. I wasn't one of those children that she left behind, but she left behind my older siblings. Mm-hmm. And my mother was able to do that because my grandmother, her mother, says, you go to Canada. There's opportunity potentially. We don't know what lies ahead, but it sounds like there's opportunity. I will take care of your two young children. And Kayla, there's an irony to me that I'm like, I'm here doing this, and my own child is in the care of my mother. Now, my mother's in her 60s. My daughter's 3 years old. Any of you who know 3-year-olds or have one, Kayla, get ready. Okay. They're a lot. And so Nova's running my mother ragged is basically what I'm saying. But I love my mother even more. I appreciate her. And I'll tell you this, writing the book and researching for years and years my mother's story, because I had to go and find social workers. I had to find the people who sponsored her. I had to talk to dozens upon dozens of people to map out this story of my mother, who left St. Lucia as a teen mother and came here, had me by accident. I wasn't planned. My bio dad, I don't know. I've never met him till this day. I'm 41 years old. Disappears and leaves her, basically. And she's in Canada as a nanny with just me. And as I was mining the story of my mother's life, the reporter lens, the broadcaster lens, the researcher lens, I approach it like, and I separate myself from being her child. Now that the book is written and people are reading it, there's one scene that everybody gravitates towards. And I remember just, I felt it when I was researching it and I was writing it and I was understanding it, but I separated myself. Now that I'm a mother and a woman now, because I wrote the book, started to write the book before I was a mother. So now that I'm a mother now and people are watching the scene. So it's the scene where it's 1980. My mother's a domestic worker. She, again, has her kids in St. Lucia. She's pregnant with me, unplanned. But her work is tied to her being sponsored as a domestic worker. So her employers are, you know, the Harrys. So she's working for them. That's how she can stay in the country. They agreed for her to stay and work, even though she's pregnant. So she's still a full-time nanny housekeeper for them around the clock. And she's worked her entire pregnancy. My mother is now 9 months pregnant with me in the late summer of 1980, August. And she knocks on the door because she's gone into labor. And she knocks on the door and her employer, Mrs. Harry, is in early in the morning. It's inconvenient for her housekeeper to now be in labor. Like, this is in Oshawa, Ontario. So my mother's now in active labor. She doesn't have a car. She doesn't have a license. She doesn't have anything. She goes back downstairs. She calls a taxi. I guess eventually Mrs. Harry must have felt some sense of guilt, right? And she's like, okay, Catherine, I'll drive you, right? And it's so amazing. Like, this is how I came into the world. This is how I came into the world. And you're telling the story of how you came in the world, but I'm also learning the story of how I came into the world, like by the hour. Mm-hmm. And yeah. And so she shoos the taxi away, but this is the part. And in the year of this book nearly being out now, I was like, oh yeah, that's unconscionable. So before she can drive my mother to give birth to me at Oshawa General Hospital in 1980, August 20 something, my mother has to cook. And mom can't cook a full meal, so she has to make tuna sandwiches. So my mom has to make 10 tuna sandwiches as she's in active labor before her employer will drive her, cut them up. And the Harrys, by the way, they don't eat crust on their bread. So there's that, all these details. So she's cut all the crust off, cut them, and then wrap them up in paper towel that's damp, and then freeze them in the freezer. So while she's gone to the hospital, and back in the days, you could spend days in the hospital, apparently, not like us now, they send you out the next day. So for days, they would have all these sandwiches. And that is what I got. This is how I was ushered into the world. So when you learn that about your origins, when you learn about the indignity that was cast upon your mother, there's a certain appreciation that I now have. And I'm like, oh my God, if I had to go into labor in that way, can't even fathom it. Can't even.
As you mentioned, I have a 3-week-old. And so the fact that I was just in active labor just weeks ago and knowing the amount of pain and discomfort that I experienced. And so to put I literally put myself in your mother's shoes, and it just gave me chills.
Yeah.
And I just, it's one of those things where you almost can't even describe or summarize just the amount of sacrifice your mother truly made for you. And there's a part of the book that I want to just quickly read off because, after, you know, knowing that expert right there, knowing what some of the things that your mom had to endure, some of the things that she had to swallow her pride, you know, in order to just continue to make a way for her and for you and your other siblings. But this is just before Athens. And it says, there I was on the top of the world, 20 years after my mother had managed to find a way to get us back to Canada, representing the very country she always believed would offer us more of life's gifts. Had mom ever dreamed when we were scraping by with no stable home to call our own that life could ever be this grand? I wanted to show her that the labels she was afraid we might carry through life, poor, bastard, fatherless, would never determine our worth, because no matter what the world said, we were worthy. She was worthy. And that gives me chills just saying that and repeating your words, because it's the sacrifice, right? And it's, and I know that she's not the only mother out there that has made sacrifices for their child. And I think that that's why this book is so relatable, because I know for me, I think immediately of my grandparents, you know, how they sacrificed, you know, and they were immigrants. They came here from the Philippines, and my other grandparents that came from Jamaica. And so the immigrant story is so true to Canada. And I know that there's probably so many people listening tonight that can think of someone who comes to their mind, you know, and she's just so strong. And so I want to ask a question again from the class, from one of the students. And this one here is from Rowena. And it says, how did the discouragement in terms of the absence of education impact your future milestones and accomplishments? And there was also a follow-up question from Wengel. How would you give advice to athletes that are competing in huge competitions that having a lot of pressure or might not have done well at their races? But I'll let you answer those questions, but it's just a lot, you know, and there's so much that your mom and you have gone through.
Yeah. You know, I think, because my mom loved school when she was a tween, she loved school, but because her family on St. Lucia, before she even had kids and became a teen parent, she loved school, but she had to drop out of school to help her parents make a living. And I know all my life and my siblings' life, my mother would always say, tell us about education. Education is your vehicle. Education is your way. And she used to tell us how much she loved school. And she said, look at me, I didn't get to finish school. And so for many years, my mother had a grade 6 education and that was it. But she made sure that and I'm trying not to get too emotional. Mm. For a long time, my mother would tell us, that's your ticket. That's your ticket. And I happened to be a good athlete as well. And so that was my other ticket. And she made sure that I didn't give up on that ticket either. And so my mom would always say this famous quote too. Like she would say, don't make foolishness with your life. And you know, West Indian families, right? Like, we are so loving and we're stern as well. And like, we'll tell you plain. And my mom would say all the mistakes that I've made, she didn't want her daughters to continue. And for me, I would be like, why is mom always saying this? Like, don't make foolishness with your life. I knew what it meant. Do not embarrass me. Don't have kids out of wedlock. Mm-hmm. Don't go, you know, meet a man and just him trick you. Don't, like, she was trying to make sure her four daughters did not. And that's what I think is beautiful about my mother's journey. She made her own way and she made sure that her children did more. And so when you ask me about athletes who are competing and racing and all the pressure and all that stuff, honestly, you have to have purpose beyond sport, because it doesn't. And Kayla, you know, look, it doesn't last forever. You have to have a purpose beyond sport. You have to have a reason beyond sport. And if my entire reason for being, raison d'être, was to be an Olympic champion or win an Olympic gold medal, I would have failed. Mm-hmm. And my mother made sure, and I don't know who people listening, you have that person in your midst. It might not be your mother. Like Kayla, it could be like your grandparents who raised you. You have those people in your midst who are going to look out for you. You know who that is. It doesn't have to be a biological parent or even biological, right? Anyways, you know who those people are looking out for you. And you have to have more beyond just your work. Just even as much as we are mothers, we have to have purpose beyond just motherhood. And I'm learning that in my journey. And our marriages and whatever it is, you have to be more than that. I don't care what industry it is. I don't care what your job title and description is. I don't care what it is. You have to be more than that. And so for me, what I always come back to is my mother instilled in me, you are all, she always say this, when I fell at the Olympics, they called my mother right away. And it's in the book. And she said to me, and I'm like, where did she find the strength? My mother said to me, you are the gold. Until this day, I don't know how my mother found that strength as I was weeping and crying and just broken to tell me that. And that immediately, it didn't take the pain away. And anyone who's ever felt pain or felt loss or been through any kind of trauma, you understand, you don't need, you want the pain to go away, but you understand that it won't go away. But if something could just take the edge off to give you some relief so you can take another breath or take another step or have another day or have another moment. And that's what my mother did to me. It signaled to me, yes, I am the gold. So mom is saying, I am more than this. I am more than this. I am more than this. And I could breathe and I could breathe. And so that's really what my mother has meant to me in my life, to be honest.
And again, you know, you say, I don't even know how she came up with the words in order to comfort you in your moment, but that just goes to show her overall strength. And you really do such a great job of alluding to just how strong she was as a woman. And what I find so beautiful is the fact that when you lay out all the things that she had to go through, like you said, essentially being stripped of things that children shouldn't get stripped of at such a young age, because she had to turn into an adult out of necessity. But then you look a few decades later, and here she is enjoying the fruits of her labor, not only in just her daughter, but in her granddaughter, in your daughter, in her grandchildren. Yes. And so she has literally shaped a generation. Mm-hmm. She has altered an entire generation, a lineage. Yes. And yes, that is powerful.
It is. And I'm so glad that you've touched on that. And I'm going to do a documentary on my mother. I'm just putting it out there. I'm going to do it. I have to. Like, that's, I think 5 years and 3 years ahead, I have to, because what you just said to me is the crux of this entire thing. Mm-hmm. And which is why sometimes we have these acts of kindness and these things that we do, and we don't see or understand how they impact, right? And I'm going to get back to the point I want to make. But for example, the Denise House, that woman's shelter, right? Where me and my mother and my sister had to go there to flee my dad when I was a young child. And sometimes you give money, sometimes you give clothes, sometimes you give bread, and you just don't ever know or understand where that dollar goes, right, where that meal went, or even literally that smile and making sure that person who is cleaning the building where you work, or, you know, whatever these jobs that some of us kind of sometimes think, well, oh, I wouldn't want to do that. The dignity that you're giving to that person is working to change a generation. They are working hard wherever you find them in that place in their life. They are working and toiling hard to make a change, right? And so my mother, what you just said to me, honestly, Kayla, to me is the whole point here. My mother has 17 grandkids, okay? And, wow. Right. And I look at our siblings. We have our wonderful jobs and careers that we have. We have our relationships. We own our homes. We have our cars. All of these things, a few generations removed from my mother's life. I think about how Nova will grow up, right? And how that's very different than my childhood, thank God. But my mother has single-handedly changed that, right? And even the day we went to like see our book in the bookstore, and I'm like, it's under Barack Obama's book. It's under Michelle Obama's book. Like, what? And my mother, it's about her life. And to your point, she has single-handedly changed a generation. And sometimes I knew I wanted to write this book because sometimes we celebrate not the wrong people, but like people who are billionaires and rich and went to Harvard and went to UFT. Mm-hmm. We don't celebrate the people in our midst that to have the most impact. And my mother, if I look at how my siblings' lives are, and so when I wrote the book, actually my nieces and nephews, so all her grandkids were like, we didn't know grandma went through this. We didn't know auntie went through this. Kayla, they had no understanding. How could they? They live in a warm house. They never had to flee to go to a woman's shelter. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
They didn't have to run outside and pick up my mother's clothes because my father threw her out in the middle of the night. They never had to, and we never had to tell them those stories. So when the book came out in the spring, they were like, their mind was blown. But my mother has changed a generation. And to me, that is a story worth telling. And that is worth celebrating, which is why where I am now and my daughter is now, that's going to continue. That generational curse has been stopped, broken, cast out. It is finished, you know?
That's so beautiful. That leads me to my next question that comes from Joshua. He asks, what was the biggest lesson you learned from your mother and from the research of your mother's life for this book? And you said you did quite a bit of research. You had to talk to some people who, you know, are no longer alive. And you also had to talk about your relationship with your father. And like you said, because you didn't hold back. There are ugly truths in this story because, like you said, your mother's story, her testimony, this book, this memoir, it's not sunshine all the time. And yes, there's so much good and there's so much achievement and accolades, but there is hardship and there is sadness and there's harsh reality in this book.
Yeah, there is. And I think people maybe thought, like, Perdita Felicien, she's going to have a memoir. She's going to talk about sports in the Olympics. And Kayla, you've read the book. You got to get to like the far end before we even get to any kind of sport, to be honest. Like, it is truly an origin story and a mother-daughter saga, right? It's multi-generation and it's layered. And I think you'll learn to appreciate me and my sport experience and my journey in... because you know that beginning. And I love what you said, that a lot of people can relate to this book, right? It doesn't matter what your race is, what walk in life you are, you can relate to so many themes in this book, the resilience, the wanting, you know, the next generation to be better than you, wanting more for your children, and your family, wanting to get up after you've fallen. How do you get up after you've fallen, right? Those are the things that I truly believe are universal. So, you know, I tackled some hard topics in this book, right? Like I talk about, you know, I have two dads in a way, right? I have the bio dad that biologically allowed me to exist, who I don't know and I've never met. And till this day, if you were to put him in a lineup with somebody, I couldn't point to who this man is, mm-hmm. right? And it impacts me even till this day. And then there's the man who raised me, who is my father, who I do love and is the only father I know named Bruce. However, in the early life, my early childhood, Bruce was abusive towards my mother. Mm-hmm. And I had to wrestle with that on the page. What does it mean? I also knew that, could I have written a really sanitized book that maybe paints our experience in a different way? Yeah, I could have. But I knew if I don't tell the truth of who we are and our experiences, even if it makes people who are, close to this story feel uncomfortable, then I wouldn't be setting myself free. And I wouldn't be understanding and discovering who I am as a woman. And I had to go back and tell the story of, yes, there was a night when I'm 6 years old where my dad is about to kick my mother out in the middle of the night. And I have to go and fetch all of my mother's things, her purse, her perfume, her shoes, her necklaces, and I have to bring them inside as my father is throwing them outside. And we did this exchange for I don't know how long. I had to tell that story. Is my father still alive? Yes. Has he read the book? I don't know. Do we discuss the book? No, we do not. I love my father. And me acknowledging and saying that I love my father does not excuse his behavior towards my mother. And so even in that passage you read where you talk about, I wanted my mother to know that all the labels that we had been given, you know how our journey maybe started and some of the stigmas with being homeless, being, bastard. I remember my dad would say that name to my mom because he's not my biological dad, but he raised me since I was a baby. And he would say that to my mother. And you remember, you're 6, 7 years old. You don't know what bastard means. Mm-hmm. And, you know, your children are bastards is what my dad would say. And I remember being so curious in my little 5 and 6 year old mind, like, you know, what is bastard? It's not good. What is bastard? Right. And it took me a while till I could go in the dictionary, you know, more grades. And I realized, oh, someone who's fatherless. Well, I'm not fatherless. I have daddy. But he was signaling to her, right? That insulting her about that, right? That just, you know, belittling her about that. And for me to write that and put that in there, Kayla, I could have kept that out, right? Yeah. But I knew it wasn't the truth of our existence. And I also know when I'm, and I asked my mother permission to write this book because you're West Indian too. You really know you to air certain kind of laundry.
Listen, right. Airing dirty laundry is not in a book, in a something that is forever.
Forever. And so my mother gave me her permission before I even started to write in October of 2014. I got my whole family together, even my siblings' children, because they were older. They're in their teens, they're in their 20s. And I asked everyone's permission. The chief permission I wanted was my mother's because she's the center figure in the story, but everyone gave me their blessing. And my mother especially gave me my blessing. And so why did my mother say yes to me writing this book and being honest and candid in the way that I am in on the page? And she said to me two things. One, I think my mother knew I was searching to find out who I was. I'm half Nigerian. It's not anything that I've ever acknowledged. It's still something till this day that I'm like, I don't know what that means to be Nigerian. I'm St. Lucian. I'm Canadian. That's what I know. And so she knew I was trying to figure out all these Black identities and all these identities that I have. And so she was freeing me as a woman to be able to do that. But the chief reason my mother gave me permission to write this book and to tell her story and our story in this way, and she said to me, Perdita, I have lived through domestic abuse. I have been down and belittled. I have been homeless, and we have lived, you know, me and your sister in a homeless shelter, in an emergency shelter. And I look where we are now. So she could look and see that our life had really changed. It wasn't easy, but she had changed it. And she said, I am not the first woman. And unfortunately, I believe that I'm not the last woman to experience that. And if you could dismantle the shame and the stigma that women carry as victims of abuse, or women who are told, well, the way that, you know, you went about life early on, that's not a good woman. She wanted me to forever dismantle that with my words. And so she gave me permission to hopefully empower other women who see themselves on the page. And in the dedication, you'll see my dedication is to my mother and my daughter, but it's also to women and children like us. And if you read the book, you understand what I'm saying when I say that.
Absolutely. And you talked about just the fact that, you know, she... this notion of her having to be strong all the time because she literally had to, right? And that is something that I know so many Black women, women of color have to take on. It's this weight of just having to endure and push through. And one thing that I sense from you and your mother's relationship now is that, you know, there's a certain amount of softness now, as far as, you know, yes, you went through that, but it is not your identity, and it is no longer what you are in at the moment. And it has not defined you. And by putting words to page, it truly solidifies that. And I think there's something really beautiful in that, especially when you're talking about a story of a Black woman navigating life to encourage her young Black daughter.
Yes, 100%, 100%. And here's the thing too. I remember doing an interview and I was talking about the book, and you know, I consume books. I think books should be critiqued. You know, books that you love, or you know, you wrestle with something that a character has done, or you're like, or what the author's in, oh, I would have written it this way. And thank God, my mother's daughter hasn't gotten any criticism that I've seen, thank God. But I remember having a conversation with Heather Raceman, who's the, you know, the CEO of Indigo. So we were doing a podcast together, just one-on-one. And it wasn't even a criticism, but she said to me, you and your mom weren't really upset. You weren't upset, like, meaning like, I guess there could have been more rage towards Bruce. There could have been more rage towards the Harrys, which is actually a very fair observation. And I think it would have made certain parts of the book maybe more juicy if you saw my mom like curse them all out, stink and carry on, right? Mm-hmm. And, but if you understand my mother, right? And when she said that to me, I'm like, that's true. But I'm like, I had to write the story as it was. And the truth is, my mother is not angry. And to your point, there's a softness to her now. And there's something about her that's always been that way. And that's my mother's armor, right? The positive energy, the positive attitude, seeing the brighter side of life, despite being in the most difficult situations, that's my mother's armor. That is her superpower. And that's what's gotten her through life. Had my mother focused on what she doesn't have, has she focused on her treatment? Had she focused on some people not paying her, even though she's a domestic worker and taking advantage of her, my mother could have not truly gotten on to the work that she needed to do to build her life and to build her children's life. That anger, that venom would have been a weight that would carry her down and that she'd have to drag on this journey. And my mother is not that kind of person. And so I think some people want me to be maybe angrier at my dad to this day. And again, I will always say this, nothing will ever excuse what he did, despite him not being that person today, right? That was decades ago. But I do know the reason I do love my dad and I have affinity for my dad is my mother has always led with that love. She's always led with that positive spirit and that positive energy. And it's not a fake. It's not a front. And there are times like me and my mother are very different. Sometimes stuff happens. I'm like, Mom, can you just curse this person out right now? Just tell him off so I feel better. That's not her energy. That's not her vibe. Do you know what I mean? And so this is who she is. And I like the softness about her. I like that sometimes, you know, I want to be more like her in this way because I will tell somebody where to go in a minute. But I want sometimes to be more like my mother because I feel sometimes as Black women, yes, we hold these weights and we're in these spaces where people might not understand us, which is why I will say this. We need to have these conversations and we need to be in these spaces where you and I as Black women can talk about our experiences and our plights and people who are not from our communities understand and are listening. That is what allyship is. You might not be able to relate. You might not understand it, but you are listening. And that listening and understanding what struggles and difficulties these different communities have allow you to be a better ally and just allows you just to be a better person because we can understand each other's walk and each other's struggle just a little bit more. And that's why sometimes I feel like you kind of want to, it might feel uncomfortable at times. It's like, well, I don't understand. I don't know. It's good to not know. And it's okay to not know. And it's okay to not understand, but it's better to listen. And it's better to say, I'm going to gather the information. I'm going to ask the questions. And I'm going to understand, like, Kayla, what do you struggle with in the workplace as a Black woman? That's how people who are in power can make change, elevate you, promote you, speak on your behalf, defend you, see something going on or see something wrong and be like, not on my watch, not on my watch. I'm not laughing at that joke with you. And I know I've taken a big, long slant, but that's why these forums, these conversations are so important so we can understand what each other is up against. It's so crucial.
It really is. And I think one thing too, that you don't specifically state out loud, but really when you read this book, you know, then you have to discuss it is mental health because you can't go through some of the things that you experienced as a young child, what you witnessed your mom go through, what your father went through, what your siblings had to endure without having to talk about mental health. And that is something across the board, race, gender, nationality, that we need to obviously, we are starting to talk more and more about. And so did you ever have a time now, as I'm sure during this journey of writing this book, where you had to reassess your mental health and really look back on, okay, yeah, what I went through really was traumatic, or what I went through is not normal, but yet I went through it and I thought it was normal because that was just my reality. But there are some things I have to unpack here.
Listen, do we have another hour? Listen, so this is the thing about being a child and being in that environment that I was with. It's my normal. It's what I know. And I don't know any different. Dad cutting off the phone so my mother can't like talk to anybody and taking the phone to work with him so that she can't take care of this child who she's nannying for. That just was normal. Dad cutting off the water and taking all the fuses to make sure we have no electricity while he's gone to work and we're sitting in darkness with no running water, no electricity. That was just normal, right? And so because I had a strong mother who didn't have the resources or the time to sit there and lick her wounds, we, Kayla, moved on to the next. And it was a constant fight and struggle to get to the next level of life, to get to the next level of life. So now she has an apartment in Pickering. It's just us. The women's shelter, the Denise House, got her that home. We're now by ourselves. It's like, okay, how does she pay her bills? How does she get a job? Like, there was no time to talk about feelings and mental health and all of that. My mother dragged us to the next part of our lives, the next level in our lives. So to answer your question about mental health, and when I finally figured that out and discovered it, is what you said. It was my life. So it didn't look any different to me. I would go to friends' houses and their houses were very different than mine. And there was a little signaling that like, oh, your dad doesn't carry on like that. Oh, mine does, right? But you're 11, whatever. It's now after writing this book at 40 something, Kayla, could you imagine? That I'm like, ah, that was some real dysfunctional beep. Do you know what I mean?
Yep.
And again, I'll admit this, I still haven't gone to counseling for that. I have not. And I know that the biggest piece I have to unpack before Nova, my three-year-old, who's our soon to turn three-year-old, really starts asking questions and turns into a young girl and a young woman, is my biological identity of my paternity, right? I don't even know if I said that right, but you know what I mean? Like, that is a side of me I know I have to unpack. Because for a long time, I'm St. Lucian, I keep saying this, I'm Canadian, but if you read My Mother's Daughter, you know that I'm half biologically Nigerian, right? Mm-hmm. Beautiful culture, wonderful, and this is so silly and cliche to say, but I have friends who are Nigerian and I love them and I get that, right? But I don't identify as that.
Right.
And there's a part of me that is saying, girl, that's problematic that you cannot even experience it or ask questions about it. It's a place you don't want to go. Here's why. And it's only now, I'd say in the last 3 months, 6 months, my mother's daughter's not even a year old, why I can't go there. And this is, I feel like this is therapy with you, girl, with people watching, but let's do therapy.
We're here.
The reason I'm admitting this to myself now, and I'm sharing this because I'm a very transparent person, and maybe this will release somebody else too. I believe for a long, I don't think about David. That's his name. Bio dad is what I call him. I don't even acknowledge him. I don't, whatever. A few times in my life, maybe twice in my life, I had moments about him and they were fast and fleeting as a teen. But I know why now. I don't acknowledge him and I acknowledge that half of my biology is because part of it is one big fat, you know what, to him. Mm. One big fat boop boop to him. And it's the one last hold I have on saying, we didn't need you. We never wanted you. My mother figured it out. You don't deserve me. You don't deserve us, which is ego, which is protecting myself. But it is how I feel. And maybe to explore that part of me is acknowledging something about him. So having said that though, Kayla, because motherhood is motherhood, and we know, I have a two-year-old, soon to be three-year-old. One day, Kennedy will ask you about you as a woman.
Right.
One day, Nova will ask me as a woman. She will ask about this grandfather that's disappeared, or who is your, and she'll always have my dad, Bruce, yes. But she'll know, right? She'll know the biology of it. What do I say to Nova? What do I say to Nova? And there's times you see in My Mother's Daughter, I wrestle with my mother not chasing bio dad a little bit more to give me some answers. And I wrestled with that, not many times in my life, but I have. And I'm like, could I be doing this to Nova? Like, should I chase this trail a little bit more or get some answers here? So if Nova ever asked me like, so are we Nigerian? Are you Nigerian? Have you ever been to Nigeria? Like, who is David? Like, should I gather some answers for her? So girl, talking about therapy, that might be in the documentary too, if it ever gets done. That's where I am with therapy. But I know we went through some heavy stuff in the West Indian community. I will say West Indian community, we are really opening up to therapy. Yes. Therapy and the talk of mental health. It's not a conversation that we would have. We give it to God, which is important. And I give it to God, but God also understands that you can need help. You can need humanly health and earthly help. It doesn't mean you're not giving it to God to also need therapy. And in the Western New culture, sometimes we wrestle up against that mentality.
Well, wow. I mean, you touched on so much. And like you said, if we only had an extra hour, I mean, there's so much more. And again, it just goes because this was just such a well-written memoir. And I learned so much about you, and I feel privileged that you really went there, and you really poured yourself and your mother's lives out there for the world to essentially take in and to grasp. And even this evening, you know, I think maybe people thought that we were going to talk records and, you know, and accolades, which we did. And there is, and because that's a part of you. But I think what I really, you know, there's just so much more. And I think that is when it comes to a lot of athletes, there's so more than an athlete, you know, that's a saying from LeBron James, right? And it's so true. And so tonight I'm glad we're able to, you know, peel a few layers back.
Yeah,
me too. Peel a few layers back. But we also, of course, want to give time for some live Q&A, questions and answers that, as we've been having this amazing conversation this evening, people are listening in. And then, of course, they want to ask some real-time questions. And so this first one, we're going to kind of step back into the athletic realm.
Yes.
This first question is, do you have an opinion about the recommendation of some that a minimum age limit be set for Olympic athletes? And, you know, that's actually that's a perfect question for you, especially because you were very young when you made your Olympic debut.
Yep, I sure was. I was 19, and then we flew to Australia, and I turned 20 while I was in the sky, like all the way to Australia. It was my 29th birthday. Or 20th birthday, 19 turning 20. I have a feeling the person who asked that question is probably wanting to ask about Kamila Valieva, who's the Russian 15-year-old. Yes. Everyone, I think, knows this story. And if you don't, basically, she's 15 years old. She's competing for the Russia Olympic Committee. But it's come out that she had, before she got to Beijing, she had that positive doping test, right? Back in December. By right, by law, she should not be competing at the Olympics. She's 15 years old. So she's been thrust into the storm of being 15, being allowed to compete, right, under conditions, and she's 15 years old. Now, I'm going to spoil it for you if you haven't seen the results. If she was the number one in the world, by the way, and her program ended today or this morning, she was probably going to win a gold medal. But what happened is they said, if she wins, we're not having a medal ceremony for anybody. But there's a lot of pressure and it's loaded. So she's 50 years old. She competes today. And it was heartbreaking to watch her performance. Yeah. Drug element aside, which I'm vehemently against, the mother in me, the humanity in me, saw that this is a 15-year-old child. Her taking drugs on her own is very unlikely. Okay. There's adults and handlers around her. So if you ask me, should a 15-year-old be able to compete in the Olympics? Yeah, I think so. I think a 15-year-old is able and capable of competing in the Olympics. I don't necessarily think there should be an age limit, although some sports like figure skating and gymnastics, you're more vulnerable at that young age. But the issue here with her being 15 is the adults around her failed her. If you ask me what this is, it's child abuse. And again, you can tell I'm not on CBC Airwaves because I can't say all this on CBC Airwaves, but you get the tea right now, okay? I don't believe that she did anything wrong of her own self. Most 15-year-olds aren't doing that. It's the people around her. But we ban the athletes and we don't dismantle the system that makes that possible. We don't punish the coaches. We don't punish the physiotherapists. We don't punish these federations that make that happen. So I don't think there should be age limits. Like, I think too young is too young, like 11 and 12. But I think if you have the right support systems in play, athletes can perform. They can rise to the occasion. I truly believe that. But in this particular case, I felt that for too young to be going through this.
Yeah. I mean, talk about pressure. And like you said, at the end of the day, no matter how mature you see what you see on your TV screen, like you said, at the end of the day, you strip away all the things. It's a 15-year-old girl with a lot of the world literally watching. And not to mention on the other side of things too, depending on your sport, you're talking peaks, right? Prime, right? So depending on, you know, yep. So as far as, you know, are you wasting a window of opportunity if you set a limit on age when it comes to the Olympics and it only happening every 4 years?
100%.
So, okay. Question number two is, I loved your book and your commentary at the Summer Olympics. Will you be writing another one?
Ooh, I like this question. That means you're ready. That means you're ready to buy a second book, maybe. Okay. Yes. So there's a second book coming. All right. However, I'm stuck. meaning it's been, the whole thing is not written. I started in 2020 to write a book, and then I stopped. COVID happened again. It was just weird. And I haven't been able to get back because I didn't know what I had come to say in the second book, which is about motherhood and my sport journey and lessons in life. And, you know, Kayla, like being a working mother and like juggling all those things. And by the way, Kayla has a book in her. I keep telling her this. Kayla has a book in her. So I'm keep putting pressure on you, girl, and put that out there for you. But we'll talk about that offline. And she has a book in her and she's going to write it. But it really,
one day.
Yes, you are. 100%. It is, because your story is, yes, about motherhood. And the book to me, I didn't know what it was about. I'm like, okay, so I have all these stories, motherhood and examples of like transitioning. And I feel like my transition from athletics to my career now has been very successful, but it wasn't fluky, right? Like there's things I did to transition well. And I'm like, there's all these lessons and I could put this together. And I didn't know, again, I keep repeating myself, what I'd come to say. Last week though, everybody, newsflash, I know what the book is about. I know what I've come to say. I know what I want to say. I know the hook, I know the crux, and I'm gonna try and sell it this year. I'm gonna try and sell it this year. So there might be an announcement. I'm not gonna give it away yet, but I know what I'm doing now. And yes, I also wanna do a documentary. So I think those two things might align, but I'm always writing and always thinking. So yes, thank you for asking that. I feel energized. I feel ready.
Re-inspired just by the question.
Yes.
You know, I want to talk about the fact that right now you are literally covering the Winter Olympics. You just mentioned it, right? And this is not your first rodeo.
No.
In fact, you, if anything, you have such a unique perspective because you literally have been the athlete. And then now you have turned onto, you are now on the opposite side where you've been in the mixed zones and then now you're hosting. So you have truly covered every facet of the Olympics. How was the transition as a summer athlete, as a, you know, track and field athlete, now covering the Beijing Winter Olympics, was there a bit of intimidation as far as some sports that you may not have been, you know, as fond of, or not even fond, but just even just having the knowledge? And how's that preparing, you know, as, yes, you're an athlete, but, you know, not every athlete will know the ins and outs of, say, golf or, say, speed skating or, you know, indoor race, whatever it may be. So how was that journey preparing for Beijing?
Listen, so they sent me, So this is my first time hosting a Winter Olympics, but in 2018, I went to Pyeongchang and I covered like 19 events in Pyeongchang. It was cold. Let me tell you, it was cold at the Winter Olympics. Did you guys know that? It was cold. And then, but before that, they had me on like the World Cup circuit covering bobsleigh and aerials and like all those things. So I had probably from like 2015, 2016, good general knowledge to get up to speed. So by the time I got to Pyeongchang, I knew. But yes, hosting and being in the mixed zone and covering, and you know, like a certain set of sports is different. As a co-host, shout out to my homie, Andrew Chang, you have to know a broad spectrum of all of the sports. You don't just have your niche that you cover and then that's it. You got to know a little bit of everything. Let me tell you, I was on Wikipedia trying to figure out curling. I was like, okay, the stone, the house. Okay, hurry, hurry, hard. They're yelling at each other. I'm like, what is this sport? What is this? But this is what I do to disarm myself, okay? I am not perfect and I don't have to be perfect. And anyone listening who has a job and has a task, you have to let yourself off the hook and you have to give yourself grace and you have to give your permission to not be perfect. And sometimes I make mistakes on air, right? I own those mistakes and I make them part of what's happening, right? I might not say a word properly and I can acknowledge that. And I think people at home sitting on their couch or watching at the bar, no, that's real. And they can appreciate that. Like, oh yeah, you totally just flubbed that. Hey, sure did. And I will say this. Yeah. But I do my research. I have my notes. I come prepared. You will never say I do not come prepared. I do my homework. And so it's intimidating, this job. I'll be honest. It's hard, this job. It is my dream job. Like this, when I retired in 2013, 2012 was the goal. It's taken 10 years. But this was the goal. And again, another little like, you know, encouragement for anyone listening. You have to plant the seeds. I planted the seed a long time ago. I didn't know when I would get a chance to host. I asked to host for years. The opportunity didn't come, but it finally came. Whatever dream and goal you have right now, I don't care your age. You could be 60 something. You could be 90. You could be 15 right now. You could be a teenager. whatever goal and aspiration you have for your life and in your life, you are deserving. You can do it, and you can plant that seed and water. It might take you a year. It might take you 10 years. It might take you half that time, but the time is going to pass anyways. Just keep tilling the soil, keep nurturing your dream and still believing. And the reason I'm well prepared, I feel like, for this hosting gig is because I would be at Mont Tremblant and freezing my tail off to cover moguls. Then I would be in Whistler covering bobsled shattering. You know, you just see my hand in on the TV. But I did the reps and I did my time, and I knew that one day I will get this opportunity and I will kill it. Not to brag, but I'm ready now, you know?
Excellent advice. That's actually a great segue for this next question. And it asks, what advice do you have for the 11 to 14 year old athletes who have to overcome body frustrations to keep them motivated in the sport during this tough period?
Oh boy. That anyone who's that 11 to 14 year old age, I feel for you. There's pressure, right? There's expectation. And there's also just a maturity and a perspective that you don't have because you're young, right? You're young. Also, social media is, you know, in my day, Kayla, us growing up, we didn't have all these
Twitter. We didn't have it.
So you could go and make a mistake in sport and it's not all over Facebook or, you know, Twitter, and there's no replay of it on, you know, Liz forever. So I feel for you in that age range and parents of that age range as well, because it's a lot. So I will say a couple things. You have to, before you go into any sporting event, whatever your sport is, it could be hockey, it could be ringette, it could be track and field, gymnastics. Before you get to a major event, it could be even be a practice or a training. You as the athlete, you can do this with your coaches, you can do this with your parents, you can do this with, you know, your teammates. You might want to win, right? You might want to take home the trophy or the medal or the banner or the ribbon, let's just say. But before you get to the arena, before you get to the field, you in your mind have what is going to be your win. That's not a tangible object. It could be Perdita is just going to do her best today. Maybe my best is good for a medal. Maybe my best is good for 11th, but that is going to be my home run, right? And that is what you are going to build your contentment and your joy around. So if you meet that, that is amazing. If you exceed that, even better, but it's okay if you don't, right? You also have to tell yourself, even if today doesn't go the way I planned, right? And you can have a journal, you can write this down, you can talk about it before you start. Even if today doesn't go as planned, and you can think about if it doesn't go as planned, not that you're preparing for that, right? You could say, I'm going to get a lesson from today though. Let's say I lose. Let's say I'm last. Let's say I'm second and I should have been first. I'm going to still get a lesson from today. And then you feel all your feels. Maybe you cry. Maybe you feel bad. You can feel bad. And it's okay to feel bad, right? Accept those emotions. That's being human. Feel it. But then after you're done feeling what you're feeling, you go back and look at what just happened. And you say, okay, what was the lesson? And believe it, Kayla, you know you and I do this even in broadcasting, even though we were elite athletes. We do this in broadcasting. Maybe I had a take on air that wasn't good. I'm like, oh, I messed up that name or that word. And then I feel bad, right? Because I don't like making a mistake. And then I come back and I say, I made a mistake. I own it. I feel really bad about it. But what's the lesson here? Say the name 10 times in your head. Read your script more. Ask your producer for a pronouncer so you know that was the lesson. And then I take that bad feeling, I ball it up, and I throw it away.
Because
I don't want to, gotta go. So from that, if you are 11 to 14, or if you're in a parent with an athlete in that young range, disarm the idea of winning and accept failure. I'm not saying you're going to always fail. I'm not saying that, but like being average or mediocre on a certain day, that's okay. That's okay. And I think we got to disarm this thing about failing and always having to win. And that starts in the home. That starts with the conversations you have with your child.
I think that's actually such an excellent point, because when you don't talk about failure or you try to avoid it in life, whether it's on the track, whether it's in life, in the classroom, what have you, it almost creates this bigger notion of what it is, because you're trying to avoid it, as opposed to understanding that it's inevitable. It's going to happen to every single person at some point in their life. Yeah. You might as well accept it and learn from it, as opposed to trying to avoid it.
Exactly. So, part of life.
Great advice. Yeah. This next question, my question for you is, how do you become your own biggest cheerleader when it comes to overcoming your own fears or disappointment? You sort of just touched on that actually, as far as just kind of letting go.
A little bit. Yeah. And that is a big one, being your own cheerleader. Mm-hmm. So, and I'm coming to this late, right? So the first thing is this, and this is for anybody. I don't care your gender. I don't care your age. This is for anybody. This is very affirming, right? And I have to feel this with being on air, because sometimes you have to stop comparing yourself to other people. You have to stop. You can aspire. You can admire, you can enjoy the way that person does their life and does them and presents and talks and what they have. You should admire that. And you, it could be a beacon or a North Star for you. I want to get to that level. I want to do this. But true joy is loving who you are, how you do what you do, the way that you do. And that is enough, right? On air, I will always only sound like me. Do I hear someone with a nice voice? I'm like, oh, I like the texture of her voice. How come God didn't give me that voice? Like, I don't like that voice. But you know what? This is the voice I have. I love my tool. I'm grateful for my tool. This is how I'm going to work my tool. And being your biggest ally, your biggest advocate, I don't care. You don't have to be on TV. This is in the boardroom, wherever, is accepting that I am unique. And I was created uniquely. And I'm different. And accepting where we are. And this is, again, and I live on Instagram, so look at me like talking down about Instagram because I live there. But this is the danger about social media, right? Is because we have these 9 perfectly curated squares in our phones, on our laptops. And all we ever see, Kayla, is the beautiful parts of people's lives. And we assume and we imagine that's exactly how their life is. And you look at where you are and you're like, well, I don't have that car. I don't have that job. I don't have that husband. I don't. And you start comparing yourself to that. So how do you get the confidence? How do you get rid of that fear? It's practice. It's talking to yourself positively. It's talking to yourself the way that you would talk to a friend. Because Kayla, sometimes the conversations we have with ourselves, we would never say that to our best friends. Do you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
We wouldn't say that. So I think it's practicing it all the time and accepting this is where you are. The other thing is, you're not always going to be confident. You think I'm always confident? Sometimes I look around, I'm like, oh boy, they want me to carry this whole show for this whole, okay. But you fake it and you pretend. And if you're not great and if you're not super confident, saying that is okay too, right? I think you disarm it. And I'm going to say this again, I'm broken record. It's just practice. Whether you need to journal or affirm or talk to a friend or talk to a therapist or whatever it is, it's practice and it's time, but it starts with you being kind to yourself and loving who you are and how you do it and not having to be anybody else but you.
Being anybody else but you takes us into this next question, because it's about your personality. This person writes, you have so much personality. Do you have the aspiration to have your own talk show?
My mother wants me to have a talk show.
You mentioned Oprah as someone who you looked up to.
I love her. Here is this too, and this is kind of tying it into what we talked about. And I want to give people into some insight into me as a woman of color, of a black woman, what's happened in my mind. Okay. And this is, I'm giving this to you. And this is very revealing. So I saw Oprah growing up, right? And I loved her. And I wanted to kind of like do that. And I've always thought I would be an actor, right? That before track, and as I was doing track, I wanted to be an actor. I wanted to be not necessarily movies or Hollywood. It could have been theater, but I wanted to act. I wanted to do that. But what happened was, as I was going through high school, okay, I didn't see anyone that looked like me, like phenotypically looked like me, right? Like, are they on TV? Sure. Are they always on TV? No. And so I saw athletes all the time that looked like me. but I just see people in film and on television. And so in my head, I'm like, I don't know if I'm like the aesthetic that would someone would like could make it in TV. And I would take drama. I would win drama awards at school. And so because I'm not seeing any of it in like TV, magazine, Hollywood, anywhere, but I'm seeing the athlete, which is still an amazing vocation. Don't get me wrong. We can be many things. So I looked at the path and I could have pursued both, but I looked at the path and I'm like, I know I can make it as an athlete because there's athletes here and they look like me. So I know that that's a path. But I really, my joy, I'm going to be honest with you, my true joy was drama. I'm dramatic. Yes, I am. And thank you for noticing. And I took all these drama classes. I was in drama. But after grade 10 and 11, I was like, there's no one that looks like you. There's no path for you. You could do it, Perdita Felicien, but that climb, girl, is too hard and too long because there's no example. Oprah wasn't an actress, right? I stopped watching soap operas by then. So Tanya Lee Williams, I love her, but she wasn't in my consciousness anymore, right? I'm not checking for YNR. I'm a teen. So I dropped that dream. I completely abandoned that dream. And the reason I share that with you, Kayla, with everyone listening is, and I know we're going to sound like a breaking record, and I hope you understand why we have to keep saying it, is because seeing somebody in that space, in any industry, we're not making these stories up. We're not saying it for attention or to, it is true. It is in your brain. It's subconsciously a signaling. It's not saying someone, it's not someone telling you you're not good enough. It's not someone saying you're not pretty enough. It's not someone saying you're not this enough. It's you subconsciously realizing, oh, well, I'll go this year. You know what I mean? And so I look back now. It's subtle. It's micro. And I'm like, wow, I would have made a damn good actress. Okay. It might not be too late, but talk show, no, but when you bring that up, it reminds me of that because that was my first love. And I've let it go, but I get to be dramatic on TV with Andrew Chang every day. Do you guys not see? Come on.
The theatrics. And I was going to say, if you love her personality too, make sure you follow her on social media because these reels, the personality just comes through in her posts. So there's that element as well. Thanks, all right. This next question says, we absolutely love watching All Round Champion as a family. You are such a great mentor to the athletes on the show. Have there ever been times where you found yourself really inspired by one of the athletes on the show? And have you kept in touch with any of them?
Mm-hmm. Good question. And thank you for being a fan of ARC. There might be some more All Round Champion in the future. Just saying, we're talking, just saying. So yes, so I'll tell you, this was a very, so All Round Champion, for anyone who doesn't know the backstory, it's a reality sports series that I host. It airs on BYU TV in the States and TVO in Canada. And basically we take 10 athletes, we film for 3 months, and every week they try each other's sports. So they're from North America and they're really good. It could be boxing, it could be skiing, it could be whatever, right? We've done 40 sports by this time and they compete every week. And at the end, we crown one an all-round champion. And I'm their guide, I'm their coach. We bring in a sports star from like curling or whatever sport they do to coach them every week for those 10 weeks. And then on the third day, they all compete. So they have to be ready within 3 days and they compete on the fourth. I think I got that right. So this was really hard for me. One as a host and one as an athlete, right? And just as a mother, this particular episode hurt me. And I've never talked about this. So season 2 was a winter season and we were doing ski jumping. And the very last sport was ski jumping. And yes, I do keep in touch with a lot of the athletes, just via Instagram and just talking to them. But one of the athletes, her name was Estella. She was from the US. She was a ski jumper. And so could you imagine for the last 9 weeks, she's been doing all the different sports, right? And the last week, she gets to showcase her sport. Because you have to understand, it's a big deal to showcase their sport and what they can do, right? They show off, a sports star comes in from the world of their sport. So the very last week of ski jumping, episode 2, the producers pull me aside when we're getting ready to film and they say, the weather is too warm for the course, for the snow and everything, for Estella, for the week, for her to safely do her jumps and for her to have her episode. So we safely cannot hold her episode at all. Y'all, I try not to cry on TV, okay? But I cried on the side just because I understand what they pour into this. She's left her family. She's left her home. And I remember crying for her, and just out of sincerity, because how do I tell her this? I also had to tell her on camera, right? Because it's TV as well, right? So there's that. And I wrestled with that choice, but that was the choice that was made. It wasn't my choice. It was a choice that was made. And I remember telling Estella this, because she's ready. She's ready to hear who her sports star is. She's ready. And I have to tell her this. Kayla, when I tell you my mother bare heart, just my everything about me was like, oh my goodness. And I hurt for her. And I felt so hurt for her. Let me tell you something about Miss Estella, though. One, the cast and crew, like the other athletes, rallied around her and carried her in that episode. And when I tell you Estella, she was hurt. She was hurt. She's maybe 14 at the time, not even 15. She was hurt, right? But you know, she rose to the occasion. She got it together. She accepted what happened. She understood. And then we, you know, we had to move the show on as we were going to progress. And she kicked butt in the finale. You know, we did a whole bunch of sports together. She kicked butt in the finale. But that was hard for me, right? That was hard for me because I'm like, this is not a job for me. It is a job, but like, I know what it means to put yourself on the line. And I take this responsibility of guiding 10 children, their children, essentially, who are elite athletes, who are away from the parents. I take that responsibility very serious. Like, I will never compromise them. And so it was hard to tell her that. God, I talk forever. Girl, I talk so long. I talk forever.
And you know what? But that just goes to show, because I wish we had another half hour, another hour. You know, I hope that people at home who have been listening this evening feel the same way, and that they were able to, you know, at least walk away with a little bit of perspective and a little more knowing more about you. I wish we had more time, but that right there was our last question. Yay. And it pretty much sums up this evening. Perdita, I can't thank you enough. I mean, of course, you know, you are someone that not only everyone here looks up to, I myself as well, but as a friend too, it has been an absolute pleasure just having this conversation with you this evening. So thank you for having this, as well as, of course, we have to thank the Canadian Museum of History for allowing us this amazing platform to just have this important conversation where we were able to kind of cover a plethora of things. So thank you.
And thank you. Yes. Thank you, everyone who's spent some time with us tonight. Thank you. And of course, yeah, thank you to the museum and all the organization behind the scenes. Kayla, thank you for coming aboard. I know Kennedy is upstairs. She's 3 weeks old. You're a new mom. I adore you so much. And thank you for like saying, yes, I will do this with you. I will do this for you, and making time, because I know that time is precious. So thank you. Thank you so much, girl.
It was truly, truly my pleasure. I just genuinely enjoyed this conversation tonight. And I also want to thank TD Bank for their support throughout this entire month, and as well as the program. It's been amazing. And I hope we can do this again soon. Yes. And again, to everyone who has been logged on this evening, thank you for joining us. And I hope you all have a great evening.